straight into our subject today. See, India is in a very, very, very transitional part of the economic evolution and cycle. Yesterday, two great leaders came to India. One obviously was Donald Trump. Anybody knows who's the other important person who came to India yesterday? Satya Nadella. Unfortunately, a lot less was written and spoken about Satya's trip yesterday because it coincided with Mr. Trump's trip, and obviously the media is capturing more of that. But in that conversation which was happening with Satya, the point was that when 28 years ago Bill Gates came here for the first time, they were exchanging notes. That's Mukesh Ambani and Satya were exchanging notes, and they said that India at that time was less than $300 billion. As an economy, it was less than $300 billion. Today, when Satya sits here, we've already become the fifth largest. We are closer to the $3 trillion mark. Somebody will say 2.85, 2.9. But if you're not a chartered accountant, which some of you are, you will round it off as salespeople or as business people, and we love to round it off upwards. So I think it's $3 trillion is the closer number. We all know we'll get to the $5 trillion mark. The only question in our mind is when. Will we get there in FY24 as the government, the Prime Minister and the ministries make us believe? Or as some of the people on the other side of the parliament think that it may not happen in FY24. But I think every citizen and every Indian believes that we will get to $5 trillion. Today, diving into our topic, logistics is one of the prime carriers of that part of the economy. I don't know how many of you know, the last time a statistics was done for this industry, it was considered to be close to $160-170 billion. That was just 2 years ago. A new one which came out this year in 2019, a white paper came out. It was said that this industry is going to be $250 billion by the end of FY20. If you look at the rapidness of growth, logistics industry on a CAGR is growing almost 3 times faster than the GDP, which is growing. Which is very interesting, because every time the logistics industry in an economy grows, it means a couple of things. Construction is booming, somewhere infrastructure, and I'm talking core infrastructure here, core infrastructure is booming, and the entire logistics movement or the goods movement is moving. So that's our topic today, and we want to see whether it's just still a vision statement or whether it's a reality. And I will take it to the panel on the left first. Deven, if may ask you know, yourself to explain the audience, what do you, as the new acquisition of Patel Roadways and the larger group, which is Stellar Group, just explain to the audience what exactly do you do? That's number one, or the company does. Number two, in your opinion, and as we were discussing, you're already managing 5 million square feet of space, and you already have direct and indirect employment of almost 15,000 people. The aspirational goal that your company has is 50 million square feet of space. And I think if anybody does maths, and we put any amount of data analytics or, you know, productivity or efficiency into it, they would become a net employer of almost 150,000 people by the time you get to that goal. So if you could just...
Thank you. Thank you, everyone. And with the provision which I heard in the first session, that people with gray hair should, you know, basically not believe that, and I fully agree that they should not believe that they have all the wisdom. With that rider, let me give you a sneak peek into what is logistics industry as we see it in Stellar value chain and also in India at this point of time. So world trade at 17 trillion trade and the logistics industry of 5 trillion, that's the world logistics. In India, as Lohit said, 215 billion, various numbers are touted by various people, but a study is going on right now by the government of India in terms of arriving at the exact number. India has slipped again in the logistics performance index, which is done by the World Bank. And in fact, in Stellar, we closely monitor that for the impact of speed and cost. Not because India has not done well, because the world is growing much faster in the logistics design and improvement in execution. So we may still take 105 hours to clear a cargo. World is already at 16 and 18 and 20 hours. We still take 40 to 70 hours to put a truck from the port and evacuate. We still have a CFS which is in the middle. So I don't want to bore you with technicalities, but we have a long way to go. Cost of logistics, one journalist wrote somewhere 14% in India. It's a stuck on. Nobody knows why that 14%. The government is now working on in various ways and bringing serious investment in road, rail, waterways, and all other policy formulations. So logistics has been granted an industry structure. I work with CII, where we are privy to a lot of government initiatives which are happening, including a portal which is going to get announced and so on. So the government of India is, if I may say so, working only on logistics. Everything else is a subset of that right now. GST is also part of that. Demonetization, all the other bills were finally supposed to improve the speed and flow of cash information and goods. That's the definition of supply chain. So we call GST a big disruptor. It took 10 years in making. I don't know what is disruption about. It was first announced in 2007. Why do we call it disruption? We were thinking about it. Most of the people had forgotten about it. It got implemented in 2017. We like the word disruption, therefore we use it. But what is the disruption? In fact, we are always late. In the world of logistics, we are way behind. For simple things of standardization, in our country, there are 100 types of trucks which require 100 types of equipment to handle at the work at the warehouse, because every truck comes with its own design because where there is no regulation. It is still not compulsory in India to have an AC fitted into a truck. Can you believe that? Because the driver would fall asleep. We are out of date, hopelessly out of date. Last year we lost 1.5 lakh people, 5 lakh people got debilitated. They lost their ability to earn. 17% of India's GDP was lost in road accidents. Road design, improvement and safety processes and systems can add 14 to 15% of GDP in the country. That will require an investment of $100 billion as per a World Bank report which got published before. So anyone who is interested today can blindly invest in logistics and the returns are humongous. Keeping all this in mind, Stellar Value Chain was started 3 years back by our promoter Mr. Anshuman Singh. We have previous experience of doing logistics business, so we are fully clued in. We believe it is the best opportunity that this country has, and any number of players like us can come and add value. What we do for a living is essentially work with companies, large companies, who move products across the country and bring speed and help them do supply chain transformation. What it means is we improve the flow of inventory by using sophisticated warehousing and transportation solutions end to end. In that context, we acquired 3 companies: Kelvin Cold Chain, which is a temperature controlled logistics company. We acquired Innovative Logistics, which is an express distribution company. And we acquired Patel Roadways about 7 months back, which is a company which does less than truckload and full truckload transportation solutions. This is so that we don't have to spend time building the network and the brand. So currently we are at the 15,000 level. We will become 1,50,000. This does not include the indirect. We will have about close to 1 lakh drivers. And we believe that logistics as a sector, and I did read various information, will add anywhere between 3 million to 6 million depending on how aggressively we invest. It is not a digital business. If you read in the newspaper, you start believing that all businesses are digital business. In India, we require physical investment in this business. Digital is a small portion of the investment, not a very big portion. And combined together, it is also ready for formalization. I was also going through the report which was given as part of this information. The formalized part of logistics is only about 15 to 20%. There is another 80% which is ready to be formalized. The logistics business has one more challenge. There are bad costs in logistics and there are good costs in logistics. So 14% of GDP, if it becomes 10%, trust me, there'll be business model, gut-wrenching business model changes, which, so for example, the company that we acquired, we have cut 25% cost and still we have not cut all the costs that are required. There are 22 different types of stationery being used. It's a 60-year-old company, which is in my other business, that process is done digitally, does not require paper. So there are lots of changes which are about to happen. And for any optimist, logistics is the best sector, you will never lose. Except that what you are going to plan in 2015 may happen in 2020 and you can still call it a disruption. So that's the way logistics operating currently in India.
Thank you so much, Deven, for giving us that insight. Paresh, if I could come to you next. He touched upon a couple of points about logistics, about disruption, which hasn't yet happened or in the meaningful manner that the IT industry speaks about. But the prime business that you are in, which is the cash movement, so that's the cash logistics business that you are in, there was a serious disruption which did happen. And everybody thought that after that disruption, we will see no ATMs, we will have no cash in anybody's pockets, we will not ever become a cash economy again. But from any of the stats that we are reading, the per capita utilization of currency notes is back exactly where it was prior to the demo. How does that impact your industry, A? Second, you are again a very large contributor to employment. If I remember correctly from our conversation, you have almost 35,000 jobs, both direct and indirect, which you are already is direct and as much is indirect. So this continues to remain a huge employment generator. So just give the audience a flavor of what you're really into, what kind of employability are we really talking about here, and how does it continue to scale up irrespective of all this so-called disruption that we talk about both in cash and currency as well as in your business itself.
Thank you, Lohit. Primarily, as Lohit mentioned, we are the largest cash logistics company in India. It's held by a private equity fund for about last 5 years. It's a PE fund by name Bering Asia, which holds 100%. And we control almost about 70% of the ATMs which are operating in the country. Apart from that, we have two different businesses. One is retail cash management, wherein all your schools, hospitals, railway stations, malls, the cash collection happens through our employees and then deposited in the bank. And the third one, which is emerging now, to our surprise, is the BFSI sector, like Hero Comp is one of the major clients which we got recently, Bajaj Finserv, because they were on a spree to offload, especially Hero. They came up with a lot of offers during Diwali. Everybody must have seen. In 500 rupees, take a motorcycle. So now the collection spree is on. So we are not a collection agent as such, but they have their own collection agents. But the money which need to be collected properly, accounted properly, has been done by us. So there is a tremendous scope, because in 2016 November, to be precise, on 8 November 2016, on 9th, we had a meeting and we said, oh my God, how are we going to survive with 30,000 people? But in the last 4 years, we added more, and going forward, probably we'll add much more people. The good disruption which had happened last year was, earlier there was no entry barrier in business. Anybody who got a good contact with a bank can get the business and start his own cash logistics company. Last year, the Ministry of Home Affairs had given guidelines and made rules that any company with more than 100 crores net worth is only eligible to get into the business. Because what used to happen earlier, there were about 15 to 20 players which were in the market. And there are 2-3 players which had lost public money to the tune of 20 crore, 25 crore, maybe in thefts because they were not compliant. So the MHA had stepped in, the Ministry of Home Affairs and the Ministry of Finance, and they had come up with regulations. So that disruption had really helped to clean the marketplace, put an entry barrier, and now there are only few players who are serious players in the field. So there are only handful, you can count them on fingers actually, and we are the top in India today to do it. In terms of number of employees and the employability which is going to increase in time to come, we are very hopeful, because 2016 November, December was bad, 17 was okay, but then again the typical Indian mentality is such wherein though the Paytms of the world and everything else had come up very well, but cash will always remain the king. So primarily we are still singing that song that cash is king, and the number of people which will get employed in this business will be very high. In terms of digitalization, we had done a lot. Earlier it used to be a lot of manual things which used to happen. A trip sheet was manual, the password were manual. Now once you enter the ATM center, the cash officer gets a geotagging and then he gets the password for the machine, which is like a OTP. So the number of frauds which will happen will be less. These are the one which may happen because of the employees. I'm not talking of the general ATM frauds, because that, for that there is a university in Bihar called Jamtara. You must have seen the serial on Netflix. So that's a different business altogether. But over here, the growth is tremendous. The kind of opportunities which are coming are very high. May it be any, every new outlet which is coming up is an opportunity for us.
Thank you. In normal circumstances, when you would have said cash is king, I would have kind of second guessed it. But I think yesterday afternoon, the RBI governor himself said cash is king. I don't know how many of you caught that statement. Though he after that, obviously because he has to also talk about digital India, so he said question mark or comma or apostrophe, whichever way you're reading the sentence, he says, but digital is defined. So I think with that, we get a perspective of what you're saying about cash and why cash would remain important. Incidentally, also a data that you gave me, for every movement of ATM, you have about 3.5 jobs on an average even today. And that continues to grow. So as much as digital disruption you've spoken about for the overall industry, it will remain human intensive. Mr. Roy, coming to you, in the morning, Ritu mentioned, and many people have alluded to that data point, ISF has often spoken about it, India's formalization remains, formal employment remains one of the most dismal data points as far as India is concerned. At about, you know, 85-86% informal employment, whichever way we look at it, but it's surely in the 80s, and I don't think so anybody can dispute that. We are second worst after only Africa. The last report I read, even Pakistan and Bangladesh are far better than us in terms of formal employment. Yes, ISF and staffing companies are doing a great service there, because the entry point to a lot of formal jobs today has become the staffing companies. And that's how people are progressing upwards. But when we look at the data from the formal side, which is about, you know, 7 crore individuals, the work that the government is doing on the skilling side, particularly what you are responsible from NSDC and the apprenticeship, do you feel that we are walking that path, and logistics can be one ingredient as an industry which can take far many more people than it's currently taking as a transition to formal economy? So Mr. Roy has put up some data points we'd like to show you.
Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. Thank you, Lohit, and thank you, the ISF, for giving me this opportunity to share a macro level possibility which maybe the nation has before us, which we can get it right or get it wrong, it depends on all of us here. So, what you were speaking about with regard to how do we bridge or connect the demand, which is not so formalized as yet, with the need of an industry to become more and more maybe formal, if you, for any better word, one can use that, or organized. So if you see this slide, which is, we've seen it so often, which is about the relevance of apprenticeship or even skilling in this entire demand supply matrix, where opportunity is huge. I don't think unemployment as such is going to be a huge, huge concern if we get it right, because the industry is growing, and industries at the logistics and a lot of other new industries will grow. There is opportunity for the educated, now the skilled manpower, to get employment in industry, and there is equal opportunity, or not equal, but a big opportunity for some of them to get employment abroad also. Because the demand of the industry, both in India and abroad, is huge. Whatever we've done till now, the industry keeps saying that your education system, your skill system does not get us ready, employable manpower. So, apprenticeship is a bridge, a possibility, which today, if we do it properly by design, skilling and apprenticeship, if we get this together, this piece together properly, I think we must look at it as a huge possibility of a win-win. So, as I would like to say two things here, that till now, and as my colleagues in the panel, co-panelists were also sharing, disruption, accident, a lot of things in India are happening by accident, including our failure of a population policy by which we become a huge economy. So, this whole thing about logistics becoming very big, GST taking a lot of time and then happening suddenly, despite it being evolving. But what happens is not so much by consultation or by design, it just happens. And because India is so large, that the impact of that happening or accident is huge. So, this thing, if it is done by design, the kind of potential it has, you can imagine. When it happens by accident, it happens. When it is done by design, what can happen? So, if you see the skill space, you have, now theoretically I will say, now today you have in the apprenticeship law, a class 5 upwards can be an apprentice. Class 5 upwards or class 8 and 10 upwards, you have formal skilling being given to them as a capsule, skill development, if they so want to do things other than education. And if it is well designed, this plus short-term training can lead to three outputs. One is regular job doesn't happen because you need to fit this person into a job scenario, not so effective, but still the most accepted way of placements. Staffing, a huge opportunity again, especially with the flexi options of staffing which staffing companies are now offering to the industry. Third, apprenticeship, and then employment, either staffing or regular employment. So that is for maybe class 10 downwards, class 5 upwards. Then you have the same people who don't do a short-term skilling course, and NSDC has about 3,000 such courses across sectors. So some people can do it and then come into these three outputs. Otherwise, if you don't do short-term skilling, you can come straight into apprenticeship. There is a basic training module and there is an on-the-job training module of an apprenticeship course. So that can happen. Then the undergraduates and then the ITIs and graduates, they can come into all of this, and if it is done well, designed well, I think it can meet that demand supply bridge. It can be a very good demand bridge between demand and supply. If you, after a graduation or an ITI pass out, if you with have apprenticeship exit options for the exiting graduates, give them a course in apprenticeship, catch them at the college level by design, give them this output and then make them employable, because you've given them a shop floor exposure or an office premises exposure, how actually work happens. And of course, lastly, and the best solution going forward, and is embed apprenticeship into the degree courses itself, so that under a formal apprenticeship contract or law, each of these students exposes himself or herself to an apprenticeship shop floor training, which is a very serious arrangement between an employer and an apprentice under an apprenticeship act, not a casual internship or so-called on-the-job training, which are there in theory, but it doesn't really have an impact. So if all of this is there for you to design, and I think the industry needs to play a much, much, much more larger role in the entire skill and apprenticeship system for this to come together. And I'm not saying industry is not playing, and I'm not saying that government has been very, very forthright or welcoming, and actually this industry government connect or industry skill connect is going places. But what I'm just trying to say is, it's a huge opportunity. The story has just started. Can we get this piece together by design? So that is what I'm saying, the possibility. Now what I wanted to tell you was that the Act, there are three ways in which the Apprenticeship Act actually gives you this opportunity. One, the Act itself. Secondly, the way this Act is being managed. And thirdly, that we are designing it as per the discussion which I just went through. Actually, we want to design it like that. We want to link up each of those outputs with a bridge, which I told you about apprenticeship in different forms, or the short-term training skilling along with apprenticeship, so that the industry can get employable people with shop floor exposure and office premises exposure. But then for that, the industry has to come forward. One thing good is that apprenticeship is law. So most of you may be knowing here, because you are staffing companies or representatives from the HR side, any company which has a workforce including contract employees on its rolls or more than 30 are mandated to engage apprentices in India at 2.5% minimum of its workforce. Secondly, it is mandated to pay a stipend to that apprentice, which has a minimum prescribed level, which is ranges from 5,000 to 9,000 rupees a month, depending on the educational qualifications of the job role. What I wanted to share with you is that the Act or the law actually starts and ends right here. After that, what the law gives you, and which the industry must know, is flexibility. It is completely at the discretion of the industry what band of apprentices it wants to engage, from 2.5% to 15%. The idea is, look at apprenticeship as a human resource recruitment tool or a training tool to make those people who are potentially employable by giving them a formal shop floor exposure or office floor exposure. Up to 15%, it depends on the company. 2.5% you can say is, if you want shop floor exposed people and then the industry doesn't come forward and offer that shop floor to the students, from where will you get those people? So 2.5% you can take as a social legislation or your own requirements. Up to 15% you design it, whether from year to year, depending on whether you are on the growth path or not. Then you design it between 6 to 36 months, the discretion is yours. You design it with the job roles you want to do. You plan your apprenticeship courses or curriculum or your plans like a human resource recruitment plan for the year. And you can decide that this year you want to do 10 apprentices in 10 different verticals, or 6 apprentices in 6 different verticals, or all in one vertical, actually the law gives you the complete discretion. There are no more quotas being prescribed by the government for the industry to plan its own apprenticeship program. The job roles you need to decide, the designing of the course you need to do, the duration of the course you need to do, you need to decide, all of it you need to decide. And it is now inclusive in the sense that the manufacturing sector was there since 1961, the service sector has also been opened up. So everybody and any establishment which has more than 30 people is actually mandated to engage apprentices. From the supply side, I have already covered it, it's no more restricted to ITIs and engineers. Class 5 upwards, depending on your need, logistics sector may not need a class 8 or class 10 person to engage as apprentice. For him, class 5 upwards, depending on the job role, bring them on, train them on the shop floor, select them as per your own HR policies, assess them and train them under your own employees, assess them, certify them. And based on your needs, if you started this course, if you don't engage them or employ them later, then I think you got that piece wrong. You can plan it better the next year. But it's all up to your design. So this is what the law says. This is the kind of discretion the law gives. Then is the way the law is being managed. The entire thing is on a portal. There are people here. In fact, Quess Corp is one of the largest users of this program. Team Lease is using this program now. So it is run on a portal. There is no need to move paper, there is no need to move people. And the last part of it is that the sector skill council CEOs, who are actually representatives of the industry itself, they are going to be the inspectors under this program if you choose optional trades on behalf of the government. And as you know, they are non-government sector people. They are all from, they have been declared public servants to manage this program on behalf of both the industry and the government. So it's a huge opportunity for all of us. So this is what I wanted to share with you. And as I said, we are designing it. We are trying to link up the colleges now. You would have seen in the budget also, there is some mention of apprenticeship embedded degree courses. But what I wanted to tell you was that if the industry does not come together with the government at this stage, in the design itself. So I'm very happy that universities, skill universities are coming up like Team Lease. Then there are some more who are, there's one in Bhubaneswar, Centurion, and some more universities who are coming together to try and link up these pieces together. We are going to degree colleges, not so much the engineering colleges, degree colleges, even in the government colleges, where actually you will get this pool of apprentices. And linking up the social science courses, commerce courses, pure science courses with apprenticeship, because each industry does not need experts to recruit people. You need to actually get the people, give them shop floor exposure, and then make them employable. So we are trying it, but this is the time that you people must come in and join this design stage process so that we get it right. These are okay. These, a lot of you now know that apprentice is not a worker, and not only does the Apprenticeship Act say so, the EPF Act also says so, and the ESI Act also says so. So they are all endorsing, the provisions are endorsing each other. Only thing they are saying is, make sure that your apprentices you engage under the provisions of the Act. Don't call anybody as apprentices. I mean, it has to, it cannot be an intern who has no contract between an industry and an apprentice. It has to be an apprentice under the Act, then you are okay. So this is what I wanted to share with you. Logistics, today we have about 85 job roles which the industry and the sector skill councils have found relevant for the short-term training, out of which 28 of these job roles have already got apprenticeship embedded in them because the industry wanted it. So they are running, these courses are running now, and most of these courses, and the most popular ones are warehouse executive, packers, hub branch operation executive, data feeders, storage and inventory executives. But as I said, there are about 80 or maybe 60 more which the industry can look at, and they are all ready to run courses for you. You just have to embed apprenticeship into them and start running them. And you can, of course, design your own courses if you don't find them relevant. So similarly, just like logistics, we had the BFSI before this. BFSI sector also has a lot of NSQF aligned courses. And we have 37 sectors. So there are about 3,000 courses which are ready to go. Apart from that, you can come forward and please design your own courses so that we get this thing together and meaningfully together with the industry and the skill ecosystem. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Mr. Roy. Two quick points, if you could just tell the audience. One, at a national level, how many apprentices does India today have? Just a ballpark number.
Okay, that's a good question. See, as you said, ASI figure. So the ASI data we have is 3 crore formal workers. And if you see, there are about 90,000 companies who are mandated to engage apprentices. And at 15%, the number of apprentices the country can engage in a base of just those 3 crore formal employment scenario is about 40 lakh at any given point of time. As against that, today, since the time NAPS came in, which is 2016, we have had only about 10 lakh apprentices. At any given point of time against 40 lakhs, we have about 3 lakh apprentices today. But what I wanted to add here was that the optional trades, which the industry is beginning to understand, the value proposition, they understood what apprenticeship is. But now they are understanding that this act is actually very interesting to look at, the way it is positioned and the way it is being managed. They are coming forward, and within a year, a little more than a year, out of this kitty, 25% of this kitty is optional trades, which I think in 15 months, if you cover 60 years, 25% of that, I think this opportunity is being seen by the industry. And I think I will not be surprised that this figure doubles every year, if not more, as the industry takes it on. And I think this time it is going to be by design. So this it's, I think, a quiet revolution which will happen over the next 2 years, provided we don't get it wrong.
Oh, thank you. I think that gives us some framework. Mr. Deven, if I could come back to you. One of the biggest pseudo employers in this country is agriculture. And one of the biggest pains that we have, and pains across, so in the rural economy, the pain we have, the farm distress we have, and recently the so-called slowdown that we are looking at, is because we were overheating these 40 cities, assuming all consumption, all growth, all GDP will move from the 40 cities, only to realize that, you know, it's just a point of time when people will stop consuming, and we will need to look back at those 55% of the population in the rural India which is not consuming. Your company does a lot of work back in villages, and you've had examples where you've transitioned people from agro to logistics, whereas we in some shape or form speak less about logistics as a case study and as a success, but often speak about manufacturing. And we think that the only transition that the economy can do is agriculture to manufacturing, manufacturing to services. I think the intermediary in between somewhere is logistics, infrastructure, construction, and the allied sectors. Just talk us through some of those case studies, what you've observed.
So typically, our logistics parks are about 100 kilometers outside any major city. And I don't know whether that can be called rural, but at most of the places, there are no eating outlets. There are no services that we take for granted. So more or less, when we start a new logistics park, we have to compete. Sometimes we have gone so deep away from the city, so deep inside the rural network, that he has choice of just going for Manrega kind of jobs also, and he likes that compared to, because there he doesn't have to do much. In our case, he will have to actually pick up cartons or parcels and load the truck and so on and so forth. So sometimes we compete in such places. But there is an irony in our country that while we keep talking about unemployment, there are vehicles standing because there are no drivers. Driver shortage is one of the big problems that we have not addressed as an industry. And it's a complex problem. It is not something that can be solved very easily. But we have realized that when we open a logistics park, we kind of have a place inside our park where a driver who's come before time or at some other schedule than the planned schedule, he gets to rest. And we started formalizing. We realized that most of the people start with buying one truck. Even our vendors, 75% of vendors in India out of 2 crore trucks are people who have less than 5 trucks. And they are typically the farmers or agriculturists who have done well, and they're looking for a steady income throughout the year. And those are the kind of vehicles that we attach in our platform, whereby we doing local distribution, etc. So you are bang on. It is not something that he may be doing half the time. Perhaps he may be also doing agricultural related, some other trade, not necessarily agriculture per se, but could be doing various other trades surrounding in that vicinity. But transportation is the only sector which goes to all the districts and gets the cargo back. So that formalization has started happening, and I suspect that will be the one of the first things that will get formalized much more faster than any manufacturing or anything else that would reach there. And as an industry, I think, and I don't know whether staffing firms, I don't know how many staffing firms here have any driver or even have an ambition of having drivers. For example, I'm willing to tie up with any staffing company which will have 1 lakh drivers on its rolls in the next whatever 6 months. I will give a plan for the next 5 years. Yeah, I don't know how many staffing companies have looked at the world like that. I hired, just to give you, I'm going a little different in, but I'm also using this opportunity. I hired 100 engineers myself in the first year of our inception. I went to 21 cities to hire 100 engineers, because then I wanted them to be placed in our 21 logistics parks. And I took about 3 months to train them. I personally trained them because there was nobody to train them. So we took them to the warehouse. We taught them supply chain. I made them supply chain MBA in 3 months myself, using all the other faculty of my company. I don't know why a staffing company cannot do this, because I will give you an order for 500 engineers in the next 2 years that I will need. Because I'm going to need them, there is no talent which is available. I will give you another order of data and process specialists who can work at the warehousing. Another order to another company that I will give you, because out of my 1.5 lakhs, I'm an orchestra conductor. I do not want to play any instrument. And if there is somebody who can do this better, I would gladly do it. But these kind of businesses do not exist in India, because there has not been a formalized company like us before. The kind of volumes that we do today, it took us 7 years in our previous avatar, 7 years back, which we have done in 2 years. And we will add another 40, 45 million, give or take 2-3 years, because in India you can't be sure, you know, timelines are fluid. But I'm saying, from an opportunity perspective, it is a clear roadmap. It is on demand that we will need. And the act that he just mentioned could also work at different levels. So starting from a workman to a loading, unloading staff, all the way to most sophisticated process designers. Everything can come into logistics, because logistics is the industry in which a large player will not be interested in doing this on our own. Even if I'm very, very good, I will never spend time trying to train people. That's not my business. And that's the kind of opportunity that is staring all of us, starting from a driver all the way to whatever you can imagine.
So thank you very much. I'm sure a lot of people from the staffing industry can meet their annual targets next year just by meeting with you. Paresh, if I could come to you. Taking on the conversation from how the industry can evolve and help employability into sectors like logistics, you on the other hand, and your company on the other hand, has experienced a different kind of a case study. You've become an entry to a lot of youth which has come into this formal sector for the first time, but you've apparently lost those people to the banking sector or the larger BFSI sector after staying a few years with you. And some of them have gone on to head businesses in the banking sector. If you could just tell the audience, because very little is ever known, saying that somebody could come to this industry for the first time, start a job, and thereafter move upwards to become, you know, business leaders in the banking sector.
To begin with, even we have a requirement of drivers. If there are any takers, please. I need about almost 500 drivers pan India. So anybody want to take the challenge, please? Because there are a lot of innovative ways through which our people are hiring drivers at local level, which at times is not something which really works well. Because my branch manager, hub manager, they will have their own ways of hiring people. And we are not long haul like what Patel does. We are within that periphery or a radius of 3 to 5 kilometers. Coming back to what Lohit had mentioned is about how people moved from our industry. The cash logistics industry is not well known. Many a times when you go to ATM, you don't know what is the blood and sweat which is gone behind in making sure that you get your money in the middle of the night. So there is another agency which normally controls the business. We are only in cash logistics. There is something called as multiple service provider, the MSPs, who are like FSS, AGS, etc. Even now we had entered that field. So when we bag an order, we hire people who in turn, they start at a very basic level of, we need to train them because there is no college, no university which gives training on how to maintain an ATM or how to put in cash into that. It's not a rocket science. Anybody with 10 standard can do it. It's, if he's little more educated, then probably he can do the first level maintenance, which we call in the industry as FLM. So which is a different call. And many a times all these people will slowly and gradually move from cash logistics to the MSPs and then to the bankers. Because banking in and out, it's like a outlet of a bank at times. We work as an extended arm of the bank, wherein all the services are provided. I'm sure 10 years from now, most of the banks, like if you take Axis, the kind of network which SBI got today is so good that every nook and corner, forget the 40 metro cities which we are focusing, but the rural part. And there is an initiative which is taken by certain state governments, like we did a major project for Rajasthan government, wherein we had set up more than 1,000 convenience centers within Rajasthan, for which we had deployed an ATM machine, we had deployed a connectivity tool so that people sitting in their own village can get connected to the world, whether it is transferring money, whether it is sending your request for passport, this, that, everything, like linking Aadhaar, all that can be done at a smallest possible village which got about 250 houses in that village. So Rajasthan was the first model which was built. Now probably slowly and steadily it will go to all the sectors. And there is one guy who gets the employment, but there are 10 other people from that village who get an employment because somebody has to come and clean it everyday basis, then somebody has to construct it, somebody has to replenish the supplies there. So all those things are generating jobs. So it's like 10,000 jobs created by putting up 1,000 convenience centers. So this is how probably the employability in logistics will increase, especially the cash logistics. And then people moving always happens. Like we have case studies within our own organization where they started as cash officers. The ATM machines came to India, most of you may be aware, in the year 2000. So it's just about 20 years that these machines are around us. And 20 years is like too early an age to get matured. So we are confident that in another 10 to 15 years, the numbers will multiply. Irrespective of whatever happens, whatever digitalization happens, people will continue to use. And interface with the banks, like the latest machines which many of you must be using are the cash depositing machines. We call them as BNA machines. So which are again an extended arm, so you don't have to see the bank counter anytime. So most of the guys who are doing it get gradually either accepted by the banks and moved to the bank at various positions, because bank currency chest department which operates, they operate only through people like CMS, and there are only 6 players today in the market. So it's slowly and gradually everybody is moving towards it. But there is a reverse flow also. There are a lot of bankers who quit banks and join us because the action is more here. Bank slowly and steadily is getting into all outsource models, like the kind of cost which they incur is very high. The regulatory authorities on banking are much higher. So as a result, the cost which they incur per transaction is higher. While through these outsourcing models, their cost comes down.
Yeah, one thing which just sitting here, I'm listening to all of us, and because it's about staffing, so one thing which comes to my mind, I just wanted to share this thought, that there is agriculture on one side, which is not so productive. A lot of people are not producing, or productive agriculturists or farmers. Then there is the government college. If you look at India, the real India, you have government college dropouts who fall by way if they don't get good jobs. And then there is this informal sector requirements like construction, logistics, even banking and insurance, those, what are they called, correspondents, business correspondents. So there are a lot of sectors who are so-called informal, who have the penetration into deep interiors of India. So they can actually convert this surplus of agriculture and the dropouts from government colleges. And the staffing company here, how it fits in is, with staffing companies coming up, I think they can, it's a huge opportunity for us as a nation, because the staffing companies can actually consolidate these local demands or informal demands into regular formal sector. Because the staffing companies I look at as fair people, paying fair price, doing fair business, and so the entire informal sector can actually get converted into a regular formal sector through the staffing companies, and the staffing companies can then give the best prices, and then this will also prevent unnecessary urbanization, unnecessary migration from the village or the rural side into the towns. And there is a demand locally which the informal sector has, which if the staffing companies can get it together, like your drivers, you said, huge, huge demands. You can actually stop the people there, stop migration, and give gainful employment right there at the doorstep, at homes of the unemployed youth. I think it can fit in very well if you can get it together. And I think the staffing company should see this opportunity and start getting their piece together and look at a huge picture of potential which is lying there, untapped still.
Good point. Thank you very much. We've completely run out of time. I know there would be people who would want to ask questions. If you could just connect with the panelists over lunch, if that's okay with everyone, rather than going into the session of question and answers right now. So thank you very much. Thanks to this great panel, which has given us the kind of perspective that we needed on logistics with real life case studies that their companies have practiced. Would request each one of you to connect with them over lunch as well.